Hello, everyone. So I've never been introduced to this such rallying music before. This is a very, very high standard, so I'm very nervous about meeting up to this big groundswell of music. Thank you for having me today. I'm very excited to chat about a topic that's very dear to my heart, which is really all about business transformation. We're looking a lot about what's happening in the future of digital and how we can all adjust our businesses accordingly. So this photo is probably going to date me a little bit, but I actually remember this. This was back when I was in fifth grade, and this is not me, obviously, although I looked remarkably similar to this when I was that age. This is obviously Bill Gates when he first introduced in 1993 Microsoft Windows. And there were a lot of revolutionary things about this version of Windows 3.1, but one of the big things, it was the first time that the TCP/IP stack was introduced. And that really allowed any PC to get on the internet, so you can go to lots of exciting sites like Yahoo. This is Yahoo circa 1995. Which at the time was manually curated to find all several hundred links on the internet. Fast forward a few years, many of you probably remember this, which was the iPod. This was the first iPod that came out in 2001. Really harking a lot to our future today about the first time we started with a kind of a multi-platform world that wasn't just PC-oriented. And fast forward another few years, there was another radical sensation of things like YouTube that came on the market, where social media, video, and a lot of the things that we take for granted today first really hit the mainstream. So looking at those things, it kind of asks an interesting question, which is, why did those things happen when they happened? And what does this mean for the future? Why is it that throughout all of computing, Windows 3.1 hit on the scenes back in 93? Why did the iPod hit when it did? And why did YouTube launch when it did in 2005? And you can actually map this out for those technical wonks out there in a pretty interesting chart, which is you can really chart these three innovations and probably every other major technology innovation that's happened across these metrics, which is based on declining CPU storage and bandwidth. So if you chart throughout the beginning of computing, CPU speed generally drops about a third a year. Many of you probably know about Moore's law. You can look at this in an inverse way and saying that computer processing power drops about a third a year. Storage drops about 37.5% a year, meaning that my hard drive today, if I want to buy the same hard drive a year from now, it'll be about a third less. And bandwidth, which is a laggard, still declines about 5% a year. And what's interesting is that while all three of these things were very revolutionary parts of technology and the internet, they all happened because at that point in time, the enabling technology finally got cheap enough that these technologies could be launched. So for example, while YouTube was this incredibly innovative thing, what most people don't realize is that YouTube was actually one of 15 different venture-backed startups in video, and they all hit around the same time, which was you could finally have bandwidth cheap enough to mainstream consumers where you could stream video. And a very similar thing goes for the iPod. The iPod was not the first MP3 player. It was actually pretty late to the market. The first iPod MP3 players hit about 2 years earlier, but that was all at the time when storage was cheap enough that you could all walk around with a hard drive in your hand. So if you look at this curve, what's interesting is that I actually think that we're hitting now the start of a period in technology that's the most innovative that'll happen and far more innovative in the last 5 years. And it's what I call the instant era, which is the era of technology that's about to happen if you continue these curves towards their logical conclusions. And I'll give you a few examples of what I mean by the instant era. And you can see that some of these technologies are starting to happen today, but they're really going to create a big groundswell in the next few years. So what does the instant era mean? Well, at a most basic level, it means truly instant internet for everyone anywhere. You might think we have that now, but if you think about it, we don't. For example, it was kind of a pain even now to get your internet access at this conference. You have to figure out how to log in and all this stuff. Your phones are very slow. You go to lots of places and you don't have internet access at all. But that's starting to radically change. Perhaps the most transformative thing is Google Fiber, which some of you may be familiar with or not. Google's rolled out and is rolling out right now in a test market in Kansas City, 1 gigabit per second internet access to the home for $70 a month. To give you a frame of reference, most of you probably pay this amount to your cable provider to get about maybe 20 gigabits per second. So you're talking about 50 times the speed to your home. This is already standard in places like Korea. And it's rolling out around the world, where the United States is actually a little bit behind the times. And if you think about what you can do with the internet at 50 times the speed of what you have today, it's pretty mind-boggling. The same thing is happening in mobile. So what's interesting is mobile, you've probably all seen the stats about the proliferation of mobile and smartphones and whatnot. But what's pretty interesting is if you look at the curve of mobile growth, of mobile broadband, I talked earlier about how YouTube, when it hit around 2005, we finally had enough bandwidth to complement those services. And what actually happened during that period was that the average internet connectivity was around 1 megabit per second. And what that meant was that you could go to a web page and it felt instant to you. And that was right about the time that a lot of the first web-based apps took off, like Gmail and so forth. And if you think about your mobile device, your mobile phone today does not feel like that. No one would ever claim that your mobile phone is instant. It feels slow, right? You have to wait for the browser to go up. A lot of apps do lots of contorted tricks to fool you into thinking it's instant, but it's really not. There's actually a lot of lag. But we're about to hit an inflection point fairly soon. The latest phones have this already, where the average internet connectivity is going to be the same speed for mobile as it was that enabled these devices to happen on the desktop. So it's a pretty profound change that's about happening. Most usability studies show that roughly 800 kilobits per second gives the user an illusion of instant speed on your phone. So that's happening, that's very big, and that means that the power that you have your desktop and the way that you feel the internet is just part of you can happen the same way as your mobile device, which doesn't quite happen today. The next really interesting thing that's happening is that you can really do anything on demand. And what I mean by this is a fun little product that I saw the other day. I'm not sure many of you have seen this, but through this mobile app called Lockatron that's coming out soon, you'll be able to unlock your door from anything, from anywhere. So if you're away and, oh my God, I gotta let the housekeeper in, I can flip on my mobile device and I can unlock my door in my house through this. Similarly, thanks to another new service that came out called Get Made, this is dear to my heart. I can flip up my mobile phone, I can get a maid coming to my house within hours of using this app. So we have this idea where anything that you want anywhere is going to be immediately available instantaneously. And we see the promise of this happening a lot, but hasn't quite hit. Probably a lot of you remember these ads for Siri that were out about 6 months ago. They had different celebrities like John Malkovich interact with their Siri. And you know, he has this mythical future where he's talking about, you know, getting coffee and whatnot, and Siri does everything perfectly. For those of you who use Siri, you know that this is definitely fantasy, not reality. But this is coming, and that's very, very transformative. And if you think about it, this is where we are today, which is you search, and what happens is you get web pages that contain the information you want, right? It's actually kind of annoying if you think about it. It takes an extra step. You search for something, go to the web page, then you find the data you want. We're close to moving for this, which is you search for the actual information you're looking for. And you can start to see that if you go to Google and you search like weather and your zip code, it'll pop up the weather on top. But the end state, which is what Siri is promising, is forget search, just do it for me. Right? I have this magical phone like my GetMade app, and I can ask what I want, and all of a sudden that's going to happen, which is very different than searching for information. So we're not far away from this mythical future where what we all really want to do is do a search like this in Google, right? You know, book dinner reservations for tonight, and it just happens, as opposed to having to search for the restaurant, call them up, make the reservations, and all those steps. So it's really combining action and search together to create instantaneous feedback where the internet can just do anything for you. The internet can't just do anything for you, but we're also entering this era where the internet can actually get anything for you on demand. And we've seen this already if you look at digital products, right? You look at the success of Netflix, which is now I can get a movie whenever I want. Those of you in the ad buying world, you can use services like Hadrium where you can do instantaneous real-time auctions, so I can buy media whenever I want right away. Or you can see this with cloud computing spaces where instead of buying lots of servers, I can get instant access for all the bandwidth and all the server space I want to run my service. But these are all digital goods. And what's very transformative is that we're entering an area where that's going to happen with physical goods as well. Just today's New York Times, there was an article about Walmart, how they're now testing for this Christmas season same-day delivery, which is something that Amazon's been testing for a while, and things like Fresh Direct, which is a grocery service in New York, has been doing for years now. We're not far away from a time when the expectation of same-day delivery, that I can get a physical product now to my house within an hour, becomes standard, and anything longer than that is unacceptable. Similarly, this is extending to a manufacturing ethos as well. So thanks to services like Alibaba, anyone, no matter how small, can get offshore stuff made in China or anywhere in Asia right away. So I don't have to be a big company to be able to do offshoring. But it gets better than that, which is that we're starting to move manufacturing to this instantaneous mindset as well. This is an interesting robot called Baxter. This just came on the market. For $22,000, you can have your own Baxter. And what's unique about Baxter is that this is the first robot that does line item assembly, like what you normally need unskilled labor for, but you can program it yourself, right? So I could buy Baxter and I could literally program it to, you know, move this clicker from here to here or put this widget in there. Stuff that you would normally would need very, very expensive robotics to produce, or you need offshore labor. Now you could do this. Literally any small business can do this right away. And now think about what happens when this isn't just $22,000, but is $2,000, which isn't that far away. Similarly, some of you may have seen how 3D printing is just now hitting the market at an affordable price point. This is now about $2,000, where you could literally print something in your home that could be a physical item. This got a lot of press lately because people got the great idea that I could print guns through this, and that created a lot of problems and interesting ethical issues. But this is on the market today, and what's going to happen in a few years when this is only $500? Anyone in their home can start to print stuff right away. So when you couple all these things together, you're looking at this era where you're looking at same-day instantaneous delivery for virtually anything, not just services, but for goods as well. And the final thing about the instant era, which I think is probably bigger than all of this, is the mentality of the consumer. And from looking in the room here, this looks like that this is won't be news to some of you, pretty obvious to many of you, which is that when you look at the post-digital world, and these are consumers who don't remember an era before the internet, people who were born in the late 80s, early 90s, or younger, they don't remember a pre-internet world. And so for them, digital is the preferred way of doing everything. And it's a pretty profound change. It's not like my old fart generation that remembers Bill Gates. I actually go online to do things. This generation doesn't go online because they're always online. They always think in this instantly connected fashion. We actually did a focus group about a year ago now for a client. And it was a group of 18-year-old women. And they were all in a room in one of those typical focus room things. And the moderator said, how often do you go online? And they all looked at us like they were kind of strange and speechless. They didn't know how to answer. And then we realized it's because they didn't know what the word online meant. Because these people were always connected and they were always digitally enabled. The idea of actually going online to do something was a foreign concept. So when you're looking at marketing to this audience, where digital is the first, where digital is the first stop for everything, it's a very different mentality. These are people who are always online. They're always connected socially. They know what they want. They won't make a decision without consulting their friends. They expect price transparency. It's a very different kind of attitude than what other generations are used to interacting with. And what's interesting about this audience is that in a few years, she'll be the primary decision maker for virtually every household and business purchase. They're now in their late 20s and early 30s is the most cutting edge part of this generation. They're hitting that sweet spot where most marketers are targeting, which is basically new moms and people are starting up new families where they're starting to enable a whole new line of household purchases. And that's going to be really when there's a transformative change, because this isn't going to be this new outlier. It's going to really be the mainstream consumer in our society. To give you a feel of this, by the next presidential election, they'll all be having kids. So it's a very, very it's a very, very dramatic change. And they're already starting to have a very big impact in our society. This is an interesting chart based on research from Forrester. And it shows the percentage of purchases in our economy that's driven by digital, meaning that I go online and I buy something from a place like Amazon, or I research something first and then I buy it in a store. And what's interesting is that starting this year in 2012, half of all purchases in our economy are the result of digital. And as the post-digitals get more and more influential and as they age, that ticks up a few percentage points each year. So we're really not far away from this time where every consumer we have in this instant era expects a digital-first orientation towards how they interact with companies, where digital is the primary and first way they're going to interact with a company or brand. What's also very, very scary to a lot of companies, especially those in the e-commerce space, if you look at the metrics, they buy more online than any other generation, which is pretty obvious, but they also purchase more of their purchases through Amazon than any other demographic. So they're buying more online through Amazon, which has a lot of very big implications to a lot of companies. It really shows the degree of which these kind of consumers expect a digital-first orientation. So what does this mean for companies? Well, the biggest thing that it means for companies in this new generation is what I call extreme commoditization. And what that means is that with all these trends you've seen, first, location is no longer a barrier to sales. That's been the case for a while when you think about products that are being shipped to you. But if you now think about instant shipping, you're really completely eliminating location as a barrier to sales. And if you think about a lot of the traditional reasons the company existed in a location, how they and how they remain competitive, it was also often because of location. Like I go to my local store because it's a block away from me. That whole advantage is going to completely go away. The second thing is transparent pricing. So we're already seeing that a lot today with the post-digital consumer, where people will do things like go in a store and they won't, before they buy a product, they'll whip out their mobile phone and check to see the price online. Already about 80% of consumers will use a mobile device while they're in a store environment before making a shopping decision. And this is only going to increase over time as those behaviors become mainstream, where pricing will become completely transparent. There won't be any way for companies to have significant pricing power. And the final big shift is that brands are not correlated to quality anymore. So in the old days, brands existed back in the day because it was a way that you would know about a quality of a product existed, right? So, you know, I go to McDonald's because I have comfort that even if, well, they might not be the best hamburgers. Actually, we're in Chicago, they are the best hamburgers. But no matter where you are in the world, you know what a McDonald's hamburger tastes like, and it has that quality associated with it. That was the traditional reasons that brands came into existence. Well, today that doesn't matter because I can ask my friends and it's my social network about what they think about a product, and I can talk to real consumers about their perceptions of quality. Roughly 91% of consumers will trust their friends' recommendations or the recommendations of strangers, as long as they're people, more than the brand's official messaging. So when you're in that environment, brands don't mean quality. Brands are much more around the emotional connection that someone has with a brand, and it's really about your personal identity to use a product, as opposed to being a proxy for quality, and that has a lot of implications for marketers as well. So for companies to compete in this world of extreme commoditization, we find that two strategies emerge, which is companies can compete at scale, meaning that you accept that we're in this open world and everything's going to be commoditized, and we're going to say, okay, you know what, we're going to compete and win in this commoditized world, but that's okay because we have so much scale that we're going to be able to win even though we're in a fully commoditized world. Or they're going to say, you know what, forget that. We're going to embrace a closed ecosystem. We're going to lock it down. We're going to verticalize your brand, which we'll talk about, and make it such a closed ecosystem that we really have no competition in many ways that the company is their own industry. And it'll become clear what this means when we go into some examples. So just to talk about these in depth, let's talk about the open model first. The open model is very straightforward, which really means it says, I'm going to win because I have a better value and I'm easier to business than anyone else. So because I have a high value and I'm easy to work with, I'm going to win. Vizio is a great example of this. Vizio is a really interesting company. Not many people know this, but it's actually the largest TV manufacturer in the United States. They sell more TVs than Samsung and all the other big manufacturers you've heard of. And they do this with a company that has 140 people based in Southern California. And their approach is that they've taken every single cost out of the value chain so they can compete on price. And they primarily sell to places like Walmart and Costco, where people don't know or care that it's a Vizio TV, but they're just excited because it's this incredibly great value that they've gotten from Walmart, this unbelievably cheap TV. So while Samsung has trouble competing in that world, they do compete in the open world when you're looking at smartphones. So another example of this would be what Samsung's very successfully done with the Galaxy, which is arguably the only real competitor now to the iPhone, and certainly the only product outside of the iPhone that makes any money. And if you look at what they've done, they've taken a similar approach to scale, which is they're going to say, you know what, we're going to use our tremendous economies of scale, being the largest company in the world, largest manufacturer, and so forth, and we're going to create a product that is based on open standards, that has no inherent competitive lock-in, but it's going to be a superior value to any other smartphone because it's got better speed and better processing power than anything else. One day, tomorrow, Motorola could come along, or LG, and produce a better phone than Samsung has now, and that's going to be the end of Samsung's business, but they feel that because of their scale, they can continue to stay ahead. You see this in a lot of other spaces as well. I think Backblaze is a great example of this. This is a relatively new company that's making a lot of waves in the online backup space. You'd think, how can yet another company compete in the world of backup? And they're doing it in a very simple way. $3.96 a month for unlimited data, and it's very easy to use the service. You install something on your computer and it just runs. And they're able to go against much more established providers of the ultimate commodity product because they've perfected a model that allows them to fundamentally offer a commodity product cheaper than anyone else. So if you look at those companies, you'll see that there's a few key aspects, which is they're able to use scale to consistently be the best value. which can be the cheapest in the case of Vizio, or it could be the best phone in the case of Samsung. Either one, it produces value. And likewise, they all make it very easy to do business because of frictionless transactions, meaning they're ubiquitously available, it's very simple, you can go online to buy it and so forth. They don't put any barriers in place for buying. So when you have the best value and easy to buy, you can win with scale in this kind of commoditized game. Now, there are a lot of companies that have embraced a closed model. And I actually think that most people in this room, when you think about your own business, will actually end up gravitating towards this as the future of your business, because not every company in the world can compete at scale. It's a very hard game to win that model. And what the closed model is saying that I'm going to win because I'm unique. I'm going to create an ecosystem and environment that means I'm unique, so I'm not subject to commoditization. And then consumers will want me because they want to be associated with my unique brand, partially through image and so forth. So Warby Parker is a very good example of this. They make eyeglasses. They're an eyeglass company. And they're one of an emerging class of what I call vertical e-commerce companies, which is to say that they design their glasses, they manufacture their glasses, they market their glasses, and they sell the glasses themselves. You can't buy these glasses on Amazon. You can only buy it through Warby Parker on their website. And by creating a fully closed ecosystem, they end up mitigating the competitive game of the Amazons of the world, because they are their own ecosystem that you can only be part of, and you can fall in love with the Warby Parker brand and the quality and so forth in their kind of controlled world that they control. Now imagine if you took the same pair of glasses and it was for sale on Amazon. You can imagine this product category page that had this glasses with a million other glasses all lined up in a big grid. Right? Forget it. You would never think this product's unique and you would never pay a premium. But because Warby Parker is totally separate, that gives you a feeling of premium and specialness that allows them to compete. Bonobos is another great example of vertical e-commerce. They make Slacks, same as everyone other Slacks, but they're communicating that it's very special and unique, and it's, again, a very closed ecosystem. You can see this all the way up the chain with Tesla, which is Elon Musk's electronic car company that just started selling their cars. And what I think is the most interesting thing about their business, outside of the fact that they're incredibly cool electronic cars, is that this is a fully integrated model. There are no dealers. You go to stores that are like the Apple stores, but are owned by the company where they just sell their cars. You buy it online. It's a fixed price. There's no negotiation. There's none of all the things that you hate about buying a car are all going away because they've developed a fully integrated model where they control the entire value chain from a consumer perspective. And this extends everything. They're even rolling out their own gas stations, which isn't gas. It'll be solar-powered fueled things to charge your batteries. So the whole entire ecosystem is fully controlled by the company. So if you look at this model, you can see that what they're doing is that all these companies are the same in that they're taking the entire business and verticalizing it. They're making a decision. They're owning every single part of the value chain, from initial product design through manufacturing and post-purchase experience, all creating one brand that extends all touch points, that has one area of emotional connection with the consumers. So there's a strong emotional affinity with the brand. And you can see a lot of companies are starting to embrace this model that are established. The most well-known example is Apple. You can see that with the Apple Store as a classic example of this kind of model. You can see that with things like Nike Fuel Band, where Nike is taking a commodity product like shoes and making them special by creating a service around it to measure your athletic performance and compete against your friends and so forth. Again, elevating commodity into a unique offering that only they can have. Similarly, you can see it for services like American Express, which has done a lot of innovative things. They recently rolled out this thing called Sync Tweet Save. So rather than just being any old credit card, because American Express is the only company with a full ecosystem, they're now creating a service where you have special tailored offers and savings based on how much you tweet. So they all follow a similar model where these companies are starting with one core product, and they're moving up and down the value chain to create a full ecosystem they can control that insulates them from competition. So if you look at all these companies, they all embrace a few attributes. The first is they have channel control. So you can buy from me and only from me, and that allows those companies to withstand the pricing pressure that companies like Amazon put upon their marketplace. They combine digital and analog to create a unique service. So by taking a physical product like a shoe and combining it with a digital service, you now have this new enhanced audience service that's uniquely Nike. And you can see this in a lot of other places, like companies like Chase rolling out the mobile apps where you can now scan a check to pay by, paper and mobile phone. All those things are creating an analog and digital service together that are unique. And because it's a service, these services create lots of data that then creates competitive lock-in. So you then have another area to verticalize your business and withstand the barriers of competition. And finally, by making it a single cross-channel experience, you can create a unique emotional feeling interacting with your brand. And the result is that consumers are able to better fall in love with your brand and your company and have the sense of identity that they're proud to be part of this company and proud to be associated with it, which creates that emotional connection that can withstand the forces of commoditization as well. So what does this mean for transforming your business? And what a lot of our research and work suggests is that to really be successful in the internet instant era, as we talked about, companies need to migrate to one of these models, which is winning through scale by being more of an open business, or winning by verticalizing your business and embracing more of a closed model. And what we find is that there are really three imperatives for transformation, or three things a company should think about as they start to embrace one of those two models. The first is this notion called users first. And the idea here is that throughout most of history, we would think about when you go to business school, you think about customers, and having this customer-first approach. But if you think about both the vertical and the open business, what they're really doing is targeting this broader mindset of users, which are basically people who are interacting with your business online and are really using your service. So the companies that have really started on this transformational road are really thinking heavily about users and a user-first approach to their business. The second thing is thinking about the software layer. So if you think about that digital-first consumer, they really want to interact with your company digital, right? The 25-year-old wants to research your product online, they want to solve their problems online. They really don't want to interact with your company any other way unless they have to. And what that means is that companies need to create what I call the software layer, which is basically this software that wraps around your business that facilitates any way a person in a company can interact with your business. So for example, if I want to buy a product through a website is a good example of a software layer because I can just buy through there. But I could also be I could also interact with a product like Siri, and Siri is then going to interact with my company through an API to allow a transaction to occur. So it's basically enabling your entire business through this software layer, which is how interactions will occur. And the idea here is that every interaction with a company can happen through digital with no humans required, which can be anything. It can be APIs, apps, a website, it can be social, any way that you can possibly interact with your business. And this is very transformational for a company because it really means that businesses have two businesses to run. They have the software layer, which is basically this shell around your company, and you have the business you're always in. So if you're a shoemaker, for example, you have your shoe business about making shoes, and you now have this software layer that has to be just as good as Amazon or Google or anyone else as their business. So it's a pretty big organizational challenge. And the way those two things come together, a user-first approach and a software layer approach, is really thinking about your business in a user-first company mindset. And what I mean by this is that there are a series of principles that we found in a lot of the research for how companies can organize their business in such a way that is oriented towards users first and really makes the software layer come to light. And there are really seven principles, which is around four areas around how people interact with users in terms of how they structure their products, marketing, sales, and customer service. And then three ways for structuring internal drivers, which are three different ways in which the company must set up their internal company to power a user-first approach, which is really how they set up their management, organization, technology ecosystem. In the interest of time, I'm not going to go through all of this, but you'll all see, and all of this really propels growth moving forward. In the interest of time, I'm not going to go through all of this right now. That could be the subject of a whole other presentation, but all of you in your handouts got a book that I recently wrote called Users Not Customers, which really goes through a lot of these principles in greater detail that you can go through on your own time, or you can go to usersnotcustomers.com, which goes into a lot of these principles in greater detail. So with that, I'll open it up with some questions. Hopefully someone will have a question.
You were saying that the younger audience is purchasing more on Amazon. Is there a reason why?
So I don't have a scientific reason, but I can postulate why, which is that Amazon has done a very good job of educating the world that if you want to buy something, you just go to Amazon and find it. And roughly the same number, what's interesting is if you look at the search metrics, roughly the same number of product-based searches happen on Google as they happen on Amazon. It's roughly neck and neck if you look at product-based searches. So the challenge for retailers is that that means that half of all people who are searching for products go to Amazon right away as their first stop, as opposed to going to Google first. And as that grows over time, that's going to be a very big problem, because it basically means Amazon's going to become the primary channel. So when you tie it to the younger generation, if you think about that audience as being much more search-oriented and much more digitally oriented, it kind of makes sense that those people have already been conditioned and trained that you just go to Amazon to search right away and you skip the Google step, and that accounts for a very high degree of their usage in Amazon.
So just a quick question. Are there any companies that are getting into the business of building this software layer, kind of a next-gen SAP? And because I haven't heard if there are. And also, from a talent perspective, how do you see that playing into the whole thing? Because if you've got a bunch of shoemakers that have to recruit, develop, I mean, it seems complicated.
Yeah, definitely. It's a good question. So to answer your first question, I haven't seen any specific companies that are building comprehensive software layers, which is mainly because it's so unique for each business, because it's really about internet enabling all the processes of your companies. But you can start to see pieces of it come to life in lots of different types of companies. If you look at, for example, services like Salesforce.com, which are doing a good job for Salesforce automation, making that very consumer-enabled. You can look at services like WordPress or Tumblr that make it very easy for companies to create a blog. So you're starting to see a lot of the software services products start to internet-enable different aspects of the organization's business in areas that would require this massive SAP implication or things like that. And then a lot of the stitching together of all those diverse services really isn't today is coming from consulting companies or for internal staff. The internal staff issue that you mentioned is very profound and significant, because generally what we find is that most companies have a shortage of digital talent. And it's generally the number one thing that when you do surveys of marketers, it's actually the number one thing that they identify as the biggest problem in more digitally enabling their business, is a shortage of talent within their company. So one of the chapters in my book called Concentric Organization just talks about that issue. In a nutshell, what we're basically suggesting is the way that we find the most effective way for companies to overcome the talent gap is really to centralize their digital activities as much as possible and to think of their business kind of like the way Facebook is doing. So if you think about Facebook, there are about 3,000 people, and they do a very good job of creating this Facebook product, which in turn enables now a billion people to very easily communicate, right? So before Facebook, it was really hard to post photos or keep up with your friends and whatnot. All that thing that would normally be very technically complicated to do, those 3,000 people have made this product that allows all those people to do it very easily. And so we try to encourage organizations to think about their digital ecosystem in the same way, which is how can a small group of people within their organization create a software for their business that allows lots of different divisions and lots of different people who might not be technically literate to be able to communicate in an effective manner by leveraging that technology. So centralization is very hard to do, because usually what happens is companies start with centralization and the centralized group does a bad job, and then everyone starts to develop their own website and their own thing independently, and then you have this giant sprawl. So it's really about having the discipline for having a team that can execute very well and really think carefully about what economies of scale can you get in the company to build something once that can be used everywhere, and then having a really good team that can bring that to life and make that happen. Yeah, so the question was basically, what is the fate of companies that embrace both a little bit of an open model, a little bit of a closed model, and if that's viable? For example, a lot of retailers, she cited as an example, are doing that. I think that there are certainly going to be cases where different parts of the business can be open and parts can be closed. For example, Apple is not truly a closed business, because the majority of Apple iPhones are actually sold through places like Verizon and Sprint and so forth. While the stores are glamorous, it's only about a third of their sales. So companies can still embrace both models, but the key is to have a clear understanding of what the strategy is behind those aspects of your business. That could be what parts are open and what parts are closed. And the risk is that a lot of companies are going to be in the middle, where they're sort of open and they're sort of closed, but they don't really have the best of either world, and the result is they fail because they don't have the real economies of scale to compete in a commodity world, or they don't have the real fully closed experience to create the benefits of a vertical product. So that's the real challenge. It's really to understand which part of your business is going to strategically compete and win across which area, and then really go for it across one of the metrics. But what I do think, though, is that for companies that are trying to take shortcuts to be both and not really be bold to make a decision, that those are the companies that are most exposed for failure, because the threat of commoditization for companies like Amazon are really profound. It's hard to overestimate the degree to which Amazon commoditizes products. You probably all see it yourself when you search for something, you see a million products that look the same. And that's going to be the fate of anybody that's competing in the commoditized open world, unless they have a real strategy to fight that. And that's the key thing that companies have to really wake up and realize.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry, Mr. Shapiro, I'm afraid we're out of time. I do apologize. I don't know if you wanted to wrap up or anything.
Thank you for your time.
Ladies and gentlemen, Aaron Shapiro.
Thank you, everybody.